And welcome. In this video, we're going to start our introduction to learning about anatomy and then some physiology afterwards. So the first chapter of pretty much every anatomy or anatomy and physiology textbook basically talks about some basics that you need to know. And it seems a little bit of hodgepodge at first. But I like to say, like, these are just basics, and we're just going to be using them throughout the semester. So I just want to hit a couple of concepts here. Nothing is too heavy in this. So just refer back to the first chapter in your textbook for this portion. So what is anatomy? Well, anatomy is the study of structures. And this class is called Human Anatomy because we are learning about the human body. It's not comparative anatomy where we're looking at any other animals. It's not mammalian anatomy where we're just looking at mammals like cats and dogs and humans. This is just human anatomy. And when we look at anatomy, that there are different types of anatomy. The first big category is called gross anatomy. And gross anatomy doesn't mean like, oh my God, it's disgusting. What are we doing with it? Gross anatomy merely means it's something you can see with your eyes, okay? So when you're looking at the outside of a person's body and you're finding bony landmarks like the nose, the ears, the chin, the cheekbones, that's gross anatomy. The type of gross anatomy that is surface anatomy. So we are going to be doing some surface anatomy. Like for instance, when we learn about bones, we're going to be learning about bony landmarks. And then you need to take that information and figure it out for your surface anatomy. So like when you're looking, for instance, at your hand and your wrist, what is this bump? What's this bony bump represent on the bone? First off, what bone is it? And then what's the bony landmark? And so later on, you'll learn, well, that's the Stylard process of the ulna, or you'll be able to make those mental connections. Another type of gross anatomy is systemic anatomy. And that's what we're going to be doing in lecture, where we're looking at the organ systems one by one. Here's the reproductive system. Here's the respiratory system. Here's the cardiovascular system. Here's the digestive system. And we're going to do a lot of that for lab, but we also do some regional anatomy. Like for instance, when you are looking for like at your arm, your upper extremity, there's muscular system stuff there. There's bony system stuff there. There's blood vessels there. There's nerves there. You need to know how they interact. What is closer to the surface? What is, you know, where is the bone located among the muscles and things like that? So we will be doing presenting stuff, maybe a systemic anatomy in the lab, but we will also be linking it regionally so it makes sense. And then developmental anatomy. So developmental anatomy means from the time when you were one cell until now, how did your body develop before you were born? And this is important for understanding why your body is the way it is, why there are variations, why you don't look like your sister. We all have a nose, but our noses all look different. There are certain parts of the body where there are remnants of the developmental anatomy. And so when it's appropriate, we will cover some developmental stuff. In other words, we're not going to be doing the entire chapter of developmental anatomy in your textbook, but we're going to be taking bits and pieces of it for the various organ systems. And then clinical anatomy. This is the part where students usually perk up because it's like, there's a lot of stuff here to learn. And at times you just kind of get bogged down. You're going like, why are we learning this stuff? And so what I like to do is like here, this is an example of a clinical scenario where it's important to understand this because this is how this disease happens, or, you know, this makes a difference. So we will have lots of example of that as the course goes on as well. Now, all that gross anatomy is stuff that we can see with our eyes, and that is different than microscopic anatomy. So yes, in this course, we're not gonna be sitting there fiddling with microscopes, although there is an online lab where we might do, where you have to, you know, learn how to use a microscope. But basically, we are going to have a lot of microscopic pictures. So you need to understand the tissues and be able to recognize different types of cells, different types of tissues. So we're going to be having a lot of that starting today, the very first day of class. And that will continue the entire course. So if you think after today or after the lecture on tissues, you are done with it, you are not. You really need to give your all, understand the parts of the cell, understand the tissues, and because we are gonna be talking about tissues for every single organ system, and you need to like be able to learn to predict if this cell is doing what is going to be in the cell, what's the tissue going to look like. So that's anatomy in comparison to physiology. So physiology is, function. So anatomy being the structure and physiology being the function, how that structure works. And so there are differences in structure and function, but one does not exist without the other. So what does this mean? It means when we are learning anatomy, yes, we may spend 80% of our time talking about anatomy, but unless you just want to be memorizing and not understanding why is this here, why is that there, we do have to touch on physiology 10 to 20% of the time, about 15% of the time. And then when you are learning physiology, you're not just going to be saying, okay, well, I can forget everything I learned for the anatomy for the structures, because now we're just talking how it works. Okay, well, any car mechanic will tell you, I can't figure out how to make your car go if I don't understand the parts. So it's the same thing with your body. If you're taking a pure physiology class, it will be 80% physiology, but then it will be drawing that other 20% on those structures. So it behooves you to do really well in the anatomy and not just try to eke out that lowest C and move up. So there are different, every time you see a change in structure, you must realize that the function changes. And if we're talking about, or similarly, if we're talking about a change in function, that means the structure must have changed. So for instance, if you go back to the three little pigs with their three different types of houses, the straw, the wood, and the brick, okay. If you just wanted mere coverage from the sun, the straw house was great, okay. But for the big winds, only the brick house worked, okay. So different structures, different functions. All right, so let's start talking about your body. There are a lot of characteristics of life. Different words are used. First thing you need to realize, it may seem like very hodgepodgey, but your body is freaking organized, okay? So this is why we started the basics and we built up, because if you don't get the basics, then you won't understand what's going on later. It's just like, if you don't learn your numbers, you can't do addition and subtraction. If you don't do that, then you can't do multiplication and division. And if you don't do that, then you can't do algebra. If you don't understand algebra, you can't do calculus. So we got all these little building blocks that we have to get through really quickly so that we can get onto the human body. So just read this section in the first chapter and understand the differences. And if you have any questions about this, just shoot me an email, and I'll be happy to go over it with you or ask me a question when we meet. All right, so how is your body organized? Well, we start with chemicals, you know, those atoms you learned about, and they're gonna make molecules. And then we're gonna put those different chemicals together. And Shazam, we're gonna learn about cells. And cells get very complicated very quickly. They have various different structures based on what the function of that cell is. But then when we take multiple cells and we put them together for common function, so two or more different cell types putting it together for a common function, that's what a tissue is. So in this class, anytime you hear me say the word tissue, I don't want you thinking of Kleenex. I want you thinking two different types of cells put together for a common function. Then if we put two different types of tissue together for a common function, two or more, that's gonna give us an organ. So stop and think of like, can you name organs in your body? Well, most of you can. You've learned about the heart. You've learned about the brain. You know you have a stomach. Ladies, you know you have a uterus. Gentlemen, you know you don't have a uterus, but you got a penis, which the lady doesn't have. So all those are examples of organs. So now thinking about those organs, they don't act by themselves. Okay, no part of your body is an island. It's very well organized. When we have two or more organs that work together for a common function, that's called an organ system. So for instance, what organ system would the brain be in? What would the stomach be in? What would the uterus be in? Okay, what would your lungs be in? What would your heart be in? So go ahead and pause this, stop and think, can you name those organ systems that they would belong in? So we have 11 organ systems in our body. And when we put those 11 organ systems and they are all functioning, that's what makes an organism, in this case, a human body, okay? So if one of those 11 organ systems quits working, well then you quit working. All right, so here are the 11 organ systems. If you notice, there's 12 pictures there, because if you look at the bottom right, these two, there's a male over here and a lady over there. So they're both demonstrating the reproductive system. So, you know, reproductive system's like one organ system, you either have, you know, one or the other. So why do 10 of these 11 have a black background? Because those are your internal organ systems, as opposed to the one with the white background, and that is your covering organ system, the integumentary system. So yes, we're gonna be going through all 11 of these, so you can't moan and groan. That textbook that I need you to get, we are going to go through all of it, except the developmental one, where we are going to be taking parts of the developmental chapter and not doing the entire thing. So yes, there's a lot that we are covering in a short amount of time. So you need to get your source of caffeine and dedicate yourself, and I'll be talking to you in person about what is needed to be successful in this class. So why do I say we need all 11? Because all 11 of these working together are giving feedback to each other to keep us in that balancing act that is called normal life. This is a physiological process known as homeostasis. And so as we go through some of the organ systems, we're going to be talking a lot more about homeostasis. So we're going to come back and revisit this a few lectures in. Now, some days, what's that homeostasis doing? Well, it's letting us sit in the barca lounger, watching some TV, having a beverage, but that's not what's going to happen when you are working on this class if you want to pass. All right, so now for some more serious topics, I need to make sure you understand these concepts right away on the first day. Our body is not solid. Inside our body, we have some cavities, okay? And on the back side, known as the dorsal side or posterior side of our body, we have cavities represented in this picture in the light blue color. And this can be subdivided into two areas. There is a cavity that's within the skull known as the cranial cavity, and it connects with a cavity that extends the entire length of your spine known as your vertebral cavity. So those are both in the more posterior or dorsal part of your body. Now, anterior towards the front or the ventral part of your body, we have two big cavities as well. Above the diaphragm, we have what is called the thoracic cavity. So the diaphragm is a muscle that is in your lower rib area, and it separates the ventral cavity. Above it is going to be the thoracic cavity, and below it is what we call the abdominal pelvic cavity. So that's the word we're going with right now. Abdominal pelvic cavity contains the abdomen and the pelvis. But right now, you don't know where the dividing line is between the two of them. So until we learn that, you can just go with abdominal pelvic cavity. But right now, let's look a little closer at that thoracic cavity, because it also has subdivisions. So here's the thoracic cavity. As you can imagine, it's the area inside your ribs above your lung, above your diaphragm, sorry. And on the two sides, it's going to contain your lungs. And in the middle, it contains your heart and some big blood vessels. And it has the airways that go to your lungs. And then it also has your food tube on the posterior aspect as well. So this thoracic cavity essentially can be divided into thirds. It's got a right third, it's got a left third, and then it has a middle third. So this middle third area is known as the mediastinum, okay? So practice spelling that word as well. Mediastinum is the area that's going to contain your heart, those big blood vessels, those airways going to your lungs, as well as your esophagus. And then to the right and to the left of it, we are going to have a pleural cavity on each side, each of which is going to contain a lung. So that word pleural cavity, I know you don't know what that means yet, but it's one of three serous cavities. So in order for you to understand that, I need to explain what a serous membrane is. So for this, I want you to envision a water balloon. Okay, now I know this one is showing a regular balloon, but serous membranes have a little bit of fluid, so it's better if you think of a water balloon, because it's not air inside the balloon, it's fluid. Okay, now if you have the balloon, it has this outer rubber part with water inside. And so now I want you to envision you're putting your fist into that balloon. And what you can see is you still have the rubber on the outside, but now your fist is also covered by the rubber, and the water is between the two layers of rubber, okay? So in this case, the rubber is a serous membrane, okay? And so we have an outer serous membrane, and then we have an inner serous membrane, which is covering the organ. In this case, we're pretending your fist is the organ, but think your fist would be the heart. So you would have this layer that's covering the outer surface of the heart. Then you would have a little bit of fluid, and then you would have this outer membrane. So serous membranes, we have three different types, and basically what they are linings of cavities that do not open to the outside, okay? So it has nothing to do with the opening of your anus to the outside, okay? So two layers in every serous membrane. How can we tell whether we're talking about the inner layer covering the surface versus the outer layer? The outer layer in each of the three types is going to be called the parietal layer, because the root word parite means wall. So this is the outer wall of it, the parietal layer. Whereas the inner layer, the layer that's covering the organ itself, is called the visceral layer, because the word viscera means organs. So taking this information, understand that between the visceral layer and the parietal layer, there is a small space which contains what? That's right, it doesn't contain air, it contains a small amount of fluid. And the reason for this fluid is to decrease the friction, for instance, when that organ moves and those two layers, the visceral and parietal layer, rub against each other, you don't get friction, because I think you know if you're rubbing your hands together like I am right now, they warm up pretty quickly. All right, so what are our three types of serous membranes? The first one, the one that surrounds the lung, is called the pleura. Okay, so that's a word we already had before because I talked about the pleural cavities being the outer parts of the thoracic cavity. So surrounding each lung, we are going to have, next to the ribs and the diaphragm, we are going to have that outer layer, that parietal pleura. Then we'll have a little bit of fluid, and then on the lung surface itself, we will have some visceral pleura. Inside the mediastinum, remember I said we have the heart? Well, the heart is also surrounded by a serous membrane known as the pericardium. Peri is a prefix which means around. Cardi is a root word which means heart. So this is a serous cavity that goes around the heart. And so once again, there would be a parietal pericardium, then there would be a little bit of parietal fluid, and then the visceral pericardium would be on the surface of the heart. And in the abdominal pelvic cavity, there is the peritoneum, which follows the exact same mechanisms what I just talked about, the pleura and the pericardium, with its visceral and parietal layers. So you notice that all of our serous membranes are in those ventral body cavities. The dorsal body cavities, the cranial and vertebral cavities, they do not contain any serous membranes. They are going to have different linings, which we'll talk about when we learn about the nervous system. Okay, so by now I think you've realized there's going to be a lot of terms in this class. In fact, there's going to be more than 1,500 terms just in the lab portion itself. That's more new words you're going to learn in one semester than if you took an entire year of a foreign language, you wouldn't be learning that many words. So there is this language, and before you tell me, Dr. Powell, English is not my native language. Okay, none of these words are in English. Okay, so being knowing English doesn't help you. Okay, anybody take Latin? Well, great, because if you took Latin, you wouldn't have learned these words there either. So, you know, taking Latin before you take this is not going to help you anyway. But it behooves you to learn these words, because if you understand the roots, you understand the prefixes and the suffixes, these last three parts I'm talking about here, then you can take those prefix, suffixes, and roots, and you can figure out what's being talked about and do a lot less memorizing. There's plenty of memorizing to do in this class. What you don't want to do is memorize a whole bunch of different terms that contain the same prefix or the same root. You want to be able to look at it and figure it out. So as you can see, we're going to have directional terms, and I already gave you examples of that, dorsal, posterior, anterior, visceral. We're going to have bony landmarks. We're going to have planes, which you'll learn your first lab session, and we're going to have a whole bunch of muscle actions, which is mostly going to be a lab thing as well. So I want to thank you for working hard, because that's the only way you're going to get through this class. So if it seems overwhelming at all, come talk to me right away, because we need to just talk if this is the right semester for you to be taking this class. Okay. You need to be organized, make your study schedule, and stick to it. And if you decide to blow off a 2-hour study session that you had planned because you got a better invitation, or there's something you want to watch on the TV, you need to figure out, where am I going to do that study session? And don't forget, if you need help, look at the models, go over the anatomy of the models, and then come back and look at what's going on. There are tutors available through the university. Make study sessions with your peers. This is the number one thing that every single semester, when I ask students, what would you tell other students to do to be successful? Their number one thing is make a peer study session with somebody else by the second day of class. And then don't forget, if you're really stumped, there are office hours where you can ask questions or shoot me your emails. If you do put in the time and effort, you can do this. But there are no shortcuts for this. So thank you, and I will see you again shortly.